Hello, everybody, and thank you for the invitation to be here in this very interesting themed conference. This contribution aims to address the benefits and implications of ongoing digital technological developments within a focus on 3D spatial technologies in excavation fieldwork practice and post-excavation study. With respect to the study of archaeological practices and knowledge production the past years, knowledge production at the trowel's edge using digital media has received ample attention. Here we argue that a special focus should also be directed towards the post-excavation life of the digital outputs. We showcased the archaeological program of Palyambela Kolindros that between 2003 and 2009 advanced one of the first working examples regarding a 3D workflow in Greece. This workflow aimed to integrate GIS in the very core of site recording, data analysis, and site interpretation. After a presentation of the original system, we look onto its recent life cycle and present examples where knowledge building is directly related to the reiterative engagement with the recorded information. We will try to substantiate an argument already raised by many that the excavation event is an historically situated metaphor into a digital archive to be immediately and perpetually transformed and reinterpreted. The Palyambela Kolindros archaeological project is an ongoing investigation of the Neolithic site situated next to the modern village of Palyambela near the town of Kolindros in northern Greece. The site comprises a low-tell-like settlement with deposits dating to all major Neolithic phases. The investigation has been carried since 2000 with specialists and excavating teams from different institutions and nationalities. System architecture made full use of Esri's ArcGIS, especially ArcSyn, for viewing spatial information in 3D, the structure of the geodatabase to store all relevant information, and the front end of Microsoft Access to register the excavation records. The entire system was complemented with a customized 3D viewing environment based on ArcObjects and Visual Basic 6 for a more responsive interface. The roots of this workflow can be traced back to methodological aspects of excavation fieldwork developed in the lab of prehistoric archaeology in Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. The central element of the methodology is the excavation unit on the left-hand side, which can be understood as a subdivision of a single depositional context or a layer. The theoretical and practical reasons behind its use have been described elsewhere. What is important in our case is that it fragments the excavation process to a greater degree, thus requiring a stronger understanding of spatial relations between units in order to proceed to stratigraphic grouping and phasing during post-excavation analysis. Likewise, it explains the importance of 3D spatial representation for exploring these relations against the actual stratification recorded as a section drawing. As a matter of fact, even since the mid-80s, in academic excavation projects like Thessaloniki Tumba, computer applications were built to visualize these units initially as running sections or plans, and subsequently as wireframes. We tried to approach the excavation universe and develop a data model that didn't break the chain with established fieldwork practices, analog or digital. We used CDOC-CRM to formalize the model. It proved very expressive during system design as it allowed the breaking of the excavation wall into a minimal set of discrete, accurately defined, and mutually associated entities. In the model, you can see in orange the entities having a spatial imprint that can be represented in a GIS and act as an access point to all data from within the 3D environment. See, for example, the excavation unit at the center of the model. The resulting model was not limited to fieldwork recording, but was extended to post-excavation processes through the inclusion of partonomic relations with higher-level entities depicted in blue, such as the stratigraphic layer and the stratigraphic group, to reassemble the excavated information into a site narrative. In terms of 3D spatial recording, a set of methods ranging from simple to complex were advanced. These included semi-automated object creation routines from primary measurements, combined transformation of measurements and images into 3D objects, and the manual editing in 3D modeling software. Using these methods, different entities with distinct geometries could be modeled and shown in 3D using a set of retinal variables such as color, size, transparency, etc. The representation of their geometry in a GIS provides the means to access and combine in a graphic view all thematic and temporal information recorded in the field and stored in the database. The resulting system, fed with both spatial and thematic data, was understood as a digital surrogate of the excavation space to be used to spatially reconnect fragmentary information, detect data patterning, and facilitate stratigraphic grouping. Obviously, among its downsides was the privileging of a predominantly visual, distance, and neutral gaze of the original excavation process, aspiring mainly in the mitigation of fieldwork misapprehensions. The addition of a custom archaeological orientated interface tried to foster improved and easier interaction with the data content. It was an incentive for project members, excavators, and specialists unfamiliar with GIS to use the system in different stages of the work and gain from recontextualizing their material. In this slide, you can see, the function of attributing excavation units to a stratigraphic layer and adding its attribute of this layer upon deciding based on the graph sum of the original values. That was the story by the end of development. We soon came to realize the difficulties in feeding the system with data, using it for analysis and preserving its usability. Since the termination of development in 2009, evidence for geodatabase versioning issues were noted within the first 2 years during test archiving in ADS. The custom interface quickly became obsolete due to operational system incompatibilities and the eventual declaration of Visual Basic as legacy. New 3D imaging and close-range photogrammetric procedures became widespread, but despite their recent adoption by the project, the 3D models produced have not been integrated with the rest of the data. Digital data feed was obviously never completely in full, especially when it comes to spatial data. As a result, the system gradually lost its character as a tool for data exploration and interpretation. In this respect, the record remains partially analog, impeding a true engagement with it, even after all this time. So keeping up with technological change has been very demanding in terms of both institutional capacities, such as maintenance of infrastructure and digital competence, and operational capacities, such as integration of new procedures. In the framework of the Ariadne Plus project, the pilot portion of the digital excavation record is prepared to be archived and disseminated. We have re-engaged with the digital aspects of the excavation archive to assess its contents and reusability. Despite the problems, the infrastructure retains much of its intended functionality and can receive new forms of data. Thus, its potential to assist site interpretation is still there. Many interesting points are starting to emerge, exhibiting the complexities of a spatially aware excavation archive. To begin with, quality checks can reveal mistakes, indicate graphical generalizations, or simply identify missing geometries that are affecting 3D spatial comprehension. In this respect, the digital creation process has to be backtracked, primary data reprocessed to correct inconsistencies. However, this implicates resorting back to the original documentation, requires provisions to ensure traceability between original and analog entries, the digital transcription, and the resulting 3D geometry. For example, the automatic processing of measurements into a 3D excavation unit was inhibited by coordinates out of bounds, the wrong ordering, resulting in twisted shapes or completely wrong geometries due to algorithmic restrictions. Their survival in the dataset hindered the visual understanding of actual spatial relations, making their remodeling a necessity. Another observation relates to alternate representations of the same data entering the archive. Between 2003 and 6, trenches 6 and 21 became the focus both for site investigation and testing the digital workflow, as the excavation revealed the complex stratigraphic sequence comprising of middle Neolithic ditch enclosures that cut early Neolithic pit dwellings, themselves cut onto the bedrock. Complementary views of the same data had been incorporated early in the system. In the left-hand side, you can see a combined phototextual representation of the interpreted stratigraphic section and parts of the ditches and pits modeled as raster surfaces. On the right-hand side, individual features, pits in yellow and the ditch in red, and stratigraphic layers were vectorized from the previous raster-based representation. Their combined viewing and exploration provided a richer visual experience, allowing the visualization of data patterns below, you can see, alongside the photo texture depiction of excavation space. The subsequent expansion of the excavation to nearby locations to investigate the early Neolithic phase of the site allowed the uncovering of the area in 2016, the cleaning of the bedrock, and the redocumentation of the surface using SFM, structure from motion. Apart from the obvious gains in the geometry, texture, and data management, it could be possible to evaluate the conservation of the 2016 surface when compared to the original documentation. However, this potential could not be fully explored due to the schematization evident, as we saw in the previous examples. As an alternative, we decided to explore a retrospective photogrammetric approach by reprocessing images from the site photo archives or leftovers from previous 2D documentation procedures using 3D imaging workflows into new, more elaborate 3D models to be fed back into the system. In this pursuit, we were lucky to have several images taken during the last days of fieldwork in 2004 by a crew member. As you can see, he was called Anthony. His photos resulted in yet another representation of the area, which included the actual trench section surface. Comparison of the two models manifested smoother break lines and lower levels in 2016, pointing to erosion forces acting on the bedrock despite its roofed protection. After this initial success, we expanded our search to locate archival material or forgotten site products that could be used to create new, more accurate surface models than we had before. This attempt was met with all kinds of results, from accurate representations to problematic textures to complete failures. However, it has opened the door to re-excavate the entire documentation archive, as well as to recheck all backups for everything that we considered as a byproduct to be deleted. Sorry, that was this slide. So you can see a nice example and a not so nice example of the retrospective photogrammetry. Likewise, alternative representations were explored for other spatial features. In this example, following work by Landeski, and colleagues a 3D point matrix at 0.05 centimeters distance for trench 1 was created. The resulting points were attributed to archaeological layers using topological functions and subsequently visualized with the appropriate 3D point symbology as voxels, vector voxels. This alternative representation, despite being scale specific and graphic intensive, allows a less schematic view of the deposits as partial properties rather than bounded objects. In contrast, we still haven't found a solution to represent auxiliary excavation units, such as for cleaning the trench or carving the section. Everything that lacks a geometry becomes a ghost in this visually privileging system. It cannot be investigated unless by reference to it. A final point relates to the reassociation of data not available at the time of excavation with the rest of the excavation archive. For example, finalized specialist studies, some after many years, can be reconnected to the excavation archive, recontextualized and collated with other evidence to explore chronological variation or material concentration versus stratification. It may be that the eventual integration with the rest of the information affects previous understandings, requires adjustments of initial interpretations. At the top image, excavation units are classified by cell material weight normalized by the unit volume, depicting a clear layered concentration within the Neolithic ditch. At the lower image, pottery material indicative of the Middle Neolithic is concentrated within the same trench. Through this concise history of digital research in Paliambela Kolindros and from examples presented, several realizations come about. Although digital excavation archives are historically specific in their making, limited by the very theoretical, methodological, and technological aspects of excavation fieldwork available at the time, they have a life of their own that transcends the moment of excavation. Obviously, this is true for analog archives as well. The main difference between the two is the addition of a new level of complexity related to data curation due to the numerical and transcoding principles of all digital media. Data in digital archives take diverse forms, from simple alphanumerical values to composite digital objects produced through a series of mathematical transformations, often black boxed, each with its own set of residue products that may prove to be worthy of keeping for the prospect of reprocessing. Data gaps and recording mistakes can enter the archive, affecting resulting digital products. However, this very process can be a way to cross-check initial data entry. We have painfully discovered that in order to explore the information held in the archive through these composite 3D representations, data and geometries had to be revisited, reprocessed, recombined. Therefore, a chain of successive and mutual references that trace composite digital information to the original field records, measurement, description is paramount. In this respect, technological changes have the potential to affect archaeological knowledge generation positively by fostering enhanced representation and flexible data interaction, and negatively, but by making digital data structures completely obsolete or untraceable. The parallel ways of data curation and archaeological knowledge production has been noted by Kostas in his grand challenge related to the curation of archaeological knowledge in the digital continuum. His call for the ontological examination of digitally enabled archaeological meaning-making practices matches recent efforts to extend the CDOC-CRM model to include different domains such as scientific observation and argumentation, excavation and archaeological buildings, digital data provenance and spatiotemporal data. The combined or collateral use of the concepts included can provide more accurate representations for the excavation process that encompass digital data production, use and curation. The benefit of this exercise can reveal changes or different views even in the ontological perception of excavation objects, as is the case already when defining a context or a unit in the past using CDOC-CRM, once another dimension is added to the equation. in addition, by placing spatial visualization as central to archaeological knowledge building processes, issues of distance and representation accuracy arise. 3D GIS platforms should primarily be understood as tools for the exploration of data in space and or time. Contrary to virtual environments that favor realism and an active embodiment of data, 3D GIS environments adhere to the established map-like cartographic principles and representational types. They do increase separation by placing the interpretive process from the point of view of an outsider, regardless of the ability in 3D to switch viewing angles or zoom in. They use map conventions and visual cues to classify, select, and retrieve information through data-led association and patterning exploration. Although the question of schematization versus realism arises, especially as new photogrammetric products have the capacity to render earlier versions as crude and inaccurate, this is not a reason per se to discard the latter. Schematization facilitates understanding through patterning, while realism can be informative of the original look and feel. A combination of both can certainly take the best of both worlds and provide a richer experience. Towards this end, geovisualization methods making use of 3D symbols, texture, and labels can enhance both the apprehension and presentation of archaeological objects. To conclude, digital technology advances affecting all types of excavation research. Excavation archives, either from a single research project or in the framework of development-led interventions, contain digital data in different forms, configurations, produced using historically situated methods and tools. It appears that trying to maintain the accessibility, usability of the excavation archive requires a great deal of technologically informed effort and frequent revisitations to information recorded already in all available media. Archaeology will always have to look back to previously compiled datasets, reprocess, reevaluate, and recombine these into new forms that are each time more distant from reality, with many intermediate processing stages and increasingly black boxed. In this sense, a digital excavation archive should be viewed, to paraphrase Matt in a different context, not as something fixed and static, but as a work in progress, never taking a finished form, but always in the process of being updated, renewed to take account of new developments. The perpetual archive can benefit from sound ontological descriptions that conceptualize knowledge building in tandem with transparent data curation and remediation practices. Thank you.
Thank you, Markos. That was great. And it's been a real theme, I think, of this morning's session, this transformation of analog into digital, and you carried on that. Can I just ask, you mentioned earlier on the privileging of the visual in these processes, and do you see it like a kind of distillation of data, which I wonder what gets left behind, do you think, through that privilege of visual?
Difficult question. A lot gets left behind. Everything material gets left behind. You decide to, even if you don't, digitize from scratch, you decide to forget about the paper and put the information somewhere where you can access it better. But then you have information. So even if you read, anything you do, you're interacting with the screen, so you are privileging visual. If you add into that a 3D GIS environment, then basically with pictures, with photorealism, with everything, then this is what you are in a sense aiming for, but you aim it because it supposedly will get you to a place that you will get a better understanding for to synthesize, but a lot gets left behind.
Yeah, sure. Kostas.
Thanks, Marco. I found this really comprehensive and also fascinating in its cohesion. There's one particular dimension that interests me a lot as we consider databases and information systems which encapsulate one way or another our evolving knowledge. And it's very, very clear that the approach that you've taken is one that really can accommodate new knowledge as it comes in and somehow sort of capture it and represent it so that it is accessible, right? Yeah. So there's this idea that goes very, very much with the initial notion of interpretation of the trowel's edge as we build, as we go, in a sense, you know, in the excavation, the post-excavation process. And it's encapsulated a little in this idea of upstreaming and downstreaming that I was writing about. You know, we just go back and re-describe as we evolve our interpretations at our later stages. So the question is really, I'd like to invite your thoughts on how can we capture this notion of evolution of our knowledge, even if we adopt an expressive system based on a model such as CDOC-CRM that allows us to parse together all these relationships. As our knowledge changes over time, how could we develop ways in order to make it accessible, that this genealogy of knowledge as it evolves, beyond, you know, just allowing us, of course, to look at different documents, you know, the notes and then the field reports, et cetera, which of course we can do. But since we've got this beautiful, beautifully organized database that allows us to navigate and traverse these events, how can we sort of do something that allows us this diachronic view of knowledge?
I think it's time for a history of digital archaeology, because I think we've reached the point where we have taken steps. The complexity of the developments can be traced. There are examples. Even how CDOC-CRM evolved is an issue or a theme to be explored. And we were discussing about it in Ariadne, actually. And I think that it will reveal certain decisions that sort of changed or centered, let's say, the view of how to proceed. And it might actually pinpoint to the solutions that affected those choices, the digital solution, the technological solutions that sort of became mainstream or attracted people, attracted attention, and sort of channeled research towards certain ends and not others. So in a sense, it has to be to become a theme for exploration by analyzing examples that have their history.
One more question.
Thank you, Marco. Paul Riley from the University of Southampton. That was a fantastic. What I'm going to say is actually a reaction to you and Eric about this computational photogrammetry and the life of images. You had this wonderful expression about retrospective photogrammetry. When you see Eric going around and looking at his columns, he has evidence in different periods. When you think about places like Palmyra and these crowdsourcing projects about capturing pictures, you brought up, you went back this temporal aspect. It seems to me we have the possibility of creating temporal Frankensteins so that we can take, particularly the upstanding archaeology, it changes ontologically, but it actually changes geometry over time. Computational photogrammetry would allow you to combine those temporal images and come out with a geometry which is true in the sense it did exist, but it never existed together. So I'm interested in this idea about it's not so much pollution, but the ontology of these are of our entities that we're studying is changing by these digital processes. So I just would like your reaction, please.
Well, yeah, exactly. The first thing that comes to my mind is, for example, an archaeological site like the Acropolis, where not only you have images from the previous century, the 19th century, but you also have a set of transformation of the actual site. And in a sense, you can have huge documents of photographic representations, and that manifest the site being restored and changed and touristified and everything. And well, this idea of making a collage, a 3D Frankenstein collage, is actually very interesting, and it can, it does have implication on the ontology of things, because you actually transform it into something completely different. But that is a really nice area for research. I mean, like, if you can use analog images to produce this kind of 3D geometries, and this will provide different opportunities to combine all these things. And another thing that comes to my mind is this recent idea of coloring movies from the early 20th century, which gives another dimension. So there are, this is the opportunities that digital technology, in a sense, provides to reusing in different ways products from different times and for different